If you don't remember anything else, remember worship the King. Because if you worship the King, you're not going to go far wrong, are you? Amen? In the good times, if you worship the King, things are going to get even better. In the struggling and the challenging times, if you worship the King will take you through. So turn to your neighbor, tell him, worship the King. Worship the King. Praise God. Hallelujah. If you still have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to turn them to the lesson that was read from the book of Psalm. Psalm 137, which was read for us this morning by our brother Callum. Just want to refer to a short portion of that scripture. Psalms 137. I'm just going to read the first four verses. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song. And they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? For the few moments that we have together, I want to share with you on the topic, how can we sing the Lord's song? How can we sing the Lord's song? Last week, for those who were here in the morning service, we had a first-class presentation by our sister Aretha, didn't we? We had a first-class presentation by our sister Aretha on explaining to us the origins of Black History Month. She let us know that it started in the U.S. And in the U.S., it's celebrated in the month of February. And here we celebrate it in October. Is that right? She let us know of the very positive contributions and affirmation of people of color. And sometimes, you know, when we think of Black History Month, we sometimes think of man's inhumanity to man through the transatlantic slave trade. Sometimes when we think of Black History Month, we might think of the Empire SS Windrush, which on the 22nd of June 1948 landed at Tilbury Dock, carrying amongst them 490 men, two women, from the islands of Jamaica and Trinidad. They came because they were called. They came because they were invited to come to this land to come and help. Amen. The ones who came, they were skilled people. They were engineers. They were tradesmen. They were nurses. When we think of Black History Month, we might think of the first national overseer for the New Testament Church of God in England and Wales. He was the late Reverend Dr. Oliver Lysaght, who writes in his autobiography, Forward March, after seeing many adverts in his homeland to come over and help, he decided to respond and come to the motherland, as it were. And the advert says, come and help and build following the Second World War. He decided to respond and arrived in the UK in 1951. Today, we would call him an economic migrant. That's what we would call it today. Lord have mercy. But he was invited just like so many others. Writing of that same period of time, our third national overseer in the UK, the late Reverend Dr. Senwell Arnold, in his book, From Skepticism to Hope, he described the hard times that were faced by the early settlers. He said that it was hard for them. It was hard for them to find accommodation. And in fact, he says in his book that when many of those early settlers, when they went to find accommodation, yes, they would look in the houses and see signs that said vacancies, but they would also see another sign that would say, no dogs, no blacks, and no Irish. It was hard times. Recently, Andy Burnham, MP, he warned that under the new immigration bill, this could mark a return to such discrimination, where the government are saying that landlords are now required to vet who they rent their property to make sure they can legally be in the land. Somebody say, Lord, have mercy. When we think of Black History Month, we may think of the stalwarts of the church. Men like Ira Brooks. Some of you might even remember him. Sadly, he died last year. Some of you might remember men like the founding pastor of this church, Reverend Dr. Curtis Gray, for example, who did not only plant this church, but the church in Huddersfield, the church in Bradford, the church in Halifax, and the church in Cardiff. And he didn't stop there. He went and planted churches in Liberia and in Nigeria. And I want to recommend to you, especially the younger generation, that you should read the life stories of some of these great stalwarts of the faith. I've already mentioned Dr. Arnold's book, From Skepticism to Hope. Ira Brooks wrote many books, but one of them was Another Gentleman to the Ministry. I recommend that to you. Curtis Gray, a few years ago, he did his biography and he called it So Send I You. And if you want to get some more books, there's one called The Storm is Passing Over by Roy Kedridge. Or there's a book by David Mitchell telling the story of Black Pentecostals in the Church of God. All of this tells us there was sacrifice by these men and women in those early days. Can someone say praise the Lord? Amen. Many of these individuals could tell stories of adversity. They can tell stories where a people were oppressed. They can tell you stories and show you wounds caused by racism. People don't like you, but I'm telling the truth. Amen. And if they were able to stand before me now, I would ask them this question. How did you manage to sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Hallelujah. In our text, in Psalms 137, the people of God found themselves in exile. They were in captivity. Because of their own fault, because of their own sin. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. Can I tell you, beloved ones, there will always be a consequence of sin. For the Bible tells us, for the wages of sin is death. But I thank God that the Bible doesn't stop there. But it says, hallelujah, but the gift of eternal life is offered to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Can someone praise the Lord? Amen. Jesus always gives us a way of escape. Turn to your neighbor and says, he gives us a way of escape. Because somebody feels trapped right now. Someone feels that they can't find a way through right now. But Jesus always gives us a way of escape. Yes, I might have messed up, but he's given me a way of escape. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Psalms 137 is a hymn expressing the lamentations of the Jewish people while they were in exile following the Babylonian conquest in 586 BC. Hear their regret, hear their remorse, as recorded in verse 1 of that particular psalm. By the rivers of Babylon, that was the location where they found themselves. There we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. When they remember the good times, when they remember the comfort zone, when they remember the good, the presence of God, they wept. Sometimes people think that the grass is greener on the other side. Am I talking the truth, anyone? Amen. And sometimes they jump ship only to find, I don't see them grass. Anyway, you understand what I mean. You understand? It's not greener at all. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Amen. Sometimes they leave and sometimes they turn from God. And that's what happened to the children of Israel. That's what happened to the people of God. And they found themselves prisoners of war. Taken from the familiar, placed in the unfamiliar. Taken from the comfortable, placed in the uncomfortable. Taken from the homeland to somebody else's land. Taken from freedom, now in a place of bondage. Amen. Do you know that many people have taken those words, rivers of Babylon, and they've turned it into a song? Did you know that? Who said Boney M? How you know about Boney M? But even before Boney M, there was a Rastafarian by the name of Brent Dow who had a group, a reggae group called the Melodians, and in 1970, they wrote a song based on Psalms 19 and this psalm, Psalms 137. And in fact, that particular version became part of the soundtrack in a film that was released in 1972 called The Harder They Come with Jimmy Cliff. And later on, that same song was popularized by Boney M. And in 1978, and they did their own cover version. And you know, I remember watching Top of the Pops. Don't condemn me. Don't condemn me. I remember watching Top of the Pops, and I thought, what a strange set of people. My memory was there was this one particular man there who dressed weird. Even for them days. And I thought, it didn't have many words. All he would do was prance about, and he had some weird moves, you remember? And I thought, what a thing, and I bet he's getting paid lots of money. But you know that particular version is still ranked in the one of the top 10 best-selling singles in the UK. Someone says, truth is truth wherever you get it. Amen? Jesus says he is truth. Anybody need truth today? If you need truth, because the world is filled of counterfeit. The world is filled with things that looks like it's genuine, but it's not genuine. But if you need the truth, you have to go to Jesus. For Jesus said of himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. Hallelujah. The truth is in Jesus. Amen. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. And Jesus said, as recorded for us in St. John chapter 8 and verse 32, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Can I tell you? Because Jesus is truth, he can make you free. Amen. You might be bound, but he can make you free. You might be confused, but he can make you free. You can be tied up, but he can make you free. Hallelujah. Can I tell you, I once was lost, but I'm now found because of the truth of Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Let me just contextualize our text for us today. Because many under the sound of my voice are not prisoners of war. I know that we think we got things tough, but we're not prisoners of war. But you know, there are those Christians and believers across the world in many places. For example, in the Middle East, who are being persecuted for the gospel's sake right now. Amen. Hundreds of Christian girls have been abducted by extremists. Boko Haram, for example. Right now. So I ask the question, how can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Hallelujah. When some of us have children who go off the rails. Hello, somebody. Amen. Some of us, we don't know why, and we go to God and we say, Lord, I've been faithful to you. I remember one pastor friend who was faithful to the Lord, and yet his son went straight off the rails. It happens to some of us, amen? Amen. And when that happens, we say, how can we sing the Lord's song? Or when we find ourselves in an abusive relationship, how can we sing the Lord's song? When we have been looking for work and it seems that every door has been closed in front of us, how can we sing the Lord's song? When we have fallen away from God and decided to go our own way, the last thing that we feel like doing is singing the Lord's song or singing the songs of Zion. It don't just feel right. Amen. The Israelites were known for their singing. Did you know that? They were known for their singing. For example, in Exodus chapter 15, verse 1, the Bible says, then sang Moses. Who sing? Moses. You know Moses is a leader, don't you? But did you know Moses was a worship leader? You didn't know that? The Bible says in Exodus 15 and verse 1, then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed us gloriously. Well, that's new, isn't it? Moses is a worship leader. Amen. Oh, when they asked the people of God were going to be delivered and they were going to cross the Red Sea. In the same book of Exodus, this time, same chapter 15, but round about verse 20, we see Miriam, the prophetess, the sister of Aaron. She took up the timbrel. Someone grab a tambourine and make some noise for me. I love to hear the tambourine. Okay, thank you. Now someone take it who can bang it. Yes, man, yes, man. It's sweet, mate, yes. Hallelujah. And those who could remember the church in the early days when there were no musicians, there was no keyboard, there was no drums, but they had tambourine and they made the tambourine sing. Amen. Oh, and the clap hand. Thank you, Jesus. But it was such a situation as they were crossing the Red Sea, according to Exodus 15 and verse 20. And Miriam, she took the timbrel and she started to play. And all the Bible says, and all the other women, they did the same and they danced. Amen. And round about verse 21, Miriam answered them, say, sing he unto the Lord. Amen. So when the people of God now find themselves by the rivers of Babylon, the Babylonians already knew that these people could sing. They had a history for them singing. They were known for their singing. So they said, sing us a song. But they answered and they said, how can we sing the Lord's song in a strange language? You see, the Lord's song is not meant for entertainment, and that's what the Babylonians want. The Lord's song is meant for worship. Hallelujah. That's why, my brothers and my sisters, you can be in the midst of a valley and sing unto the Lord and experience a change in the atmosphere. Am I talking to anybody? Amen. My brothers and my sisters, don't allow your present condition, which is only temporary anyway, to dictate you whether or not you sing the Lord's song. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Amen. Even though you might feel strange because of what you're going through, still do it. Amen. Have I got a witness in the house that you didn't feel like singing the Lord's song? You had trouble and trials, but somehow God put a song in your heart. Hallelujah. And all of a sudden the burden was rolled away. Mm-hmm. The devil doesn't want to do it, but tell your neighbor, sing it, man. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Some of you might be sick and don't feel like singing, but sing.
Some of you might be depressed and don't feel like singing, but sing them. Some of you might be bereaved and don't feel like singing, but sing unto the Lord.
Mm-hmm. You know, in the book of Acts, in the 16th chapter, we read of Paul and Silas, and you didn't know that they were prayer warriors and worship leaders, did you? You thought Paul was a teacher and a preacher and a theologian. But first of all, he was a worshiper. Amen? And as we look in the book of Acts in that 16th chapter, we see that they were thrown in jail. Not just the ordinary jail, but the inner courts. Not just any person looking after them, but the head jailer. And just in case they had any ideas, they put them in stocks. That means they chained them to the wall. It's bad enough you put me behind bars and lock the door. I can't go nowhere. But you chain me to the wall like I'm an animal. That's what they did to Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas had lots of opportunity to focus on their current situation. They could have said, woe is me. They could have said, Lord, look how you have abandoned me. But the Bible don't tell us they did anything like that. But the Bible says at midnight, somebody said midnight. Hallelujah. At midnight, the devil thinks that it's all over for you. At midnight, he thinks that you're down and out. But at midnight, they began to sing praises unto God. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Watch this. We focus on what happened next. And next, the Bible says, and the prisoners heard them. I remember a brother who used to complain to me about his wife because she could not worship the Lord quiet. And he will be fearful at night because she will be shouting and singing and say, hallelujah! All 12 o'clock at night. No. And he will complain to me, saying, Pastor, talk to my wife. Because he said, I'm sure the neighbors can hear this. Sometimes you must make noise, let the neighbors hear you. Amen. We often focus on that the prisoners heard them. But watch this. I believe the devil heard them praise. Amen. The devil who thought, we got you now. Amen. Instead of hearing them crying and being self-pitying, they heard them sing praises unto Almighty God. Amen. I don't know what they were singing, but indulge me for a moment. Maybe they were singing, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Maybe they were singing, I will sing the wondrous story of Christ who died for me, how he left his home in glory for the cross on Calvary. Maybe they were singing, he's coming back. He's coming back again. He went away not to stay. He's coming back again. He's coming back. He's coming back again. Singing glory, hallelujah. He's coming back. Again, I really don't know what Paul and Silas were singing. But I do know they learned to sing the Lord's song in a strange land. Amen. Not based on their current position. Not based on their current circumstance. But based on their relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. And I want to encourage you, my brothers and sisters. You can sing the Lord's song regardless of what you're going through. If you focus on the goodness of Jesus. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. As they worship God, there was a shaking. As you worship, there's going to be a shaking and pushing you forth. As they worship God, the doors that were locked were open. Anybody need some doors opening for you? Hallelujah. Can I tell you, as I sensed this in the spirit, some of us has been trying to force the door. We've been trying to kick the door open. Hallelujah. But if you can learn to sing the Lord's song, all you need is to worship God and the door would open. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There was a shaking. The doors were open, but it didn't stop there. All those that were tied up. All those that were shackled. All those that were in bonds. All of a sudden, they look. It loose. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anybody feel tied down today? Anybody feel shackled? Anybody need to be loosed? In the name of Jesus, learn to sing the Lord's song. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord of Jesus. You know, the wise preacher Solomon in Proverbs 18 verse 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. The devil wants you to be quiet. He wants you to come to church and look stoosh. He wants you to come and focus on your problem. You know, sometimes you could be, your body could be one place and the rest of you is somewhere else. The devil loves that. Let your focus on your problem. Focus on everything that is going wrong. That's what he wants. Amen. He doesn't want you to praise him. He doesn't want you to worship God. But you know what? Instead of focusing on what's going wrong, let's focus in what's going right. What's going right is, if you've got Jesus in your life, Jesus is nice, nice, nice. Amen. Somebody says, Jesus is all right. Amen. Let me behave myself. With my hands lifted up and my mouth filled with praise, with a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. With a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee. The Reverend Dr. Oliver Lysite, he learned to sing the Lord's song in a strange land. Many of our parents and our grandparents had to go through some stuff, let me tell you. Some of the stuff they went through that haven't even shared the fullness with the children. But they went through some hard times for you and I. Amen. But most of all, many learned to sing the Lord's song in a strange land. You know, I might not have got it all together right now. And I'm not going to pretend that life is a bed of roses. Amen. But I hear the psalmist say in Psalms 96, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name, show forth his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the heathen, his wonders among all people. For the Lord is great. Someone say, the Lord is great. The Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. And round about verse 9 of Psalms 96, it says, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. I don't know who I'm speaking to, who the Lord sent me for this word for somebody. But you feel that you are in a strange land right now. What you're going through. And you've done all that you can do to come to church. Are you hearing me? You've done all what you can do to come to church. In spite of what you went through, in spite of the trial, in spite of the testing, you've done all you could do to come to church. You fix yourself up, you put your nice clothes on, and you got yourself to church. And you thought, well, I've done all that I can do now. I've got to church. But the Lord said there's something else you need to do. You need to sing unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Those songs of Zion. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Somebody needs to worship the way out of their trouble right now. Amen. Somebody needs to get to what's that thing they used to call? That oil thing? What used to have on locks that used to squeak? WD-40. You're preaching with me, brother. Some of us need some WD-40 on our jawbone. Because it tight. Isn't me not making no joke, you know? Because we need to open our mouth. Listen, listen, listen. When the worship team stand there to sing, you know, it's not a spectator thing. You must open your mouth and sing unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Listen, I love when the choir sing, but the Lord must give you your own song of praise. Hallelujah. And even if it's one person who the devil said, you got you quiet and you're going to leave this place. And say, you know what? I'm going to sing unto the Lord. Can I give you a secret? It don't matter what the voice sound like. This is not X Factor. Amen? Praise God. Almost 30 years ago, in the midst of my despair, in the midst of my heartache, the words of a song that I have not spoken, never mind sang for decades, come back flooding to me. But this time they come with meaning. And as I laid in my bed, by myself in the room, by myself in the house, by myself, I sang these words, and tears came rolling down my face as for the first time I understood amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found.
Hallelujah. I was blind. But now I see. Hallelujah. 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 The songs of Zion can turn us around, beloved ones. Amen. Amen. I want you to stand to your feet right now. Worship team. Worship team, will you come? And I know that you're probably prepared a song, but I would love a hymn. Hallelujah. We're going to sing the songs of Zion. And if there's somebody under the sound of my voice who feel that you are in a strange land and find it's hard to praise, run to this altar while the anointing is in the house, that you might be loosed in the name of Jesus. Listen, listen, it's not a time to be bashful. It's not a time to be thinking, well, what are people going to be thinking? This is about you and your God. Hallelujah. So as the worship team just sing a hymn, just come to this altar. If you need salvation, come to this altar. If you need deliverance, come to this altar. If you need lifting up, come to the altar. If you need strengthening, come to the altar. Jesus would meet you there.